Thank you.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. Good morning to you. The birds are chirping.
The Eye Opener.
And I'm a kid and I know what I'm doing. Patience and I know what I'm doing. Baby, staring at it, I know what I'm doing. Staring at a gladiator, talking about a revolution. No, this is not a game.
And good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome to the Eye Opener, your weekly dose of something absolutely, positively different. Oh boy, it's been quite a while. I think I've been away from the show now almost a month. A lot of things have happened. We have some housekeeping things to go through today. For those of you who tuned in last week and are tuning in once again this week, which I hope is most of you, I regret to inform that our co-host, Natina, will no longer be joining us on the Eye Opener, unfortunately. There's been an issue with some of the things that were said. I don't know how much detail I can go into. Unfortunately, this is not the first or second or third time something of the sort has happened on the Eye Opener. We've had many co-hosts in the past for varying reasons, whether it be they work in particular government agencies or government ministries and are giving gag orders that they cannot speak about the things they speak about on our show. Or in instances where people leave the country, which is some of our co-hosts who I'm not going to talk any of their business, but kudos to them for escaping the Bahamas and going to the United States and or Canada. Either or, who knows? So good morning, Tate. How are you doing?
Good morning, Donna. Everything's good. How are you, Mark?
I am, being very honest, I am absolutely exhausted. Tired. I've finally come full circle, Tate, and understanding the age-old saying that peace of mind is so worth so much more than money.
I left a pass on that one.
You pass? Well, that's your prerogative. No, I'll take the peace of mind, actually. Teach their own, though. You know, we all have different paths in life, and we all go at different rates. So, Aaliyah, how are you doing this morning?
I'm good. I'll tell you what, today's motto is iron into nothing and nothing into me. That's my motto today, for sure. Like, I have had such an exhausting week. This school is whooping my butt. The schedule is so rigorous. They have us in RBDF Defense Force training, basically, every morning for an hour. I'm shook. I'm shaken, I'm stirred, but I'm here, and I'm happy to be here, so.
Well, you know, they want to keep you guys looking a particular way to, you know, do the whole, I don't know, have you told the audience what you're studying? Would you rather keep that private? If that's so, we respect that.
No, I'm, so, guys, I probably should announce this. It's been a little while, and I've settled in properly, and I'll probably announce something online, and wherever else, all the other media forums, but I've moved. I'm in London. I'm studying professional acting and drama at the London Academy of Music and Dramatic Art, which is the top conservatory in the continent. So on this side of the world. And I'm still at Columbia University in New York studying biochemistry and sociology. But I am taking a bit of a break this semester just to get settled in here before I jump back into my traditional studies. So I'm going to do the three of those degree programs at the same time, like a crazy man, but it's got to get done. But that's where I'm at right now. For anybody who is wondering why I'm always on Zoom now and not in the studio.
And we all know Tate has left us to become, to embrace his American roots. I'm kidding, Tate.
Why, Tate, don't come back with no accent, nah.
No, that won't be the case, no.
I should hope
not. Crazy though, is it just me, Tate, or like I feel extra bohemian? Like, extra, now that I'm here, I turn up the bohemian. Like I refuse to let anybody think that I'm anything other than bohemian. Like, I will let people. Like, I'm walking around. Like, every morning when I come in, my earphones, like, I blast, like, and I let people know I'm Jamaican, too. I blast the dance hall. I'll put on, like, Rake and Scrape, and I'll blast that on my earphones so people could know, like, I'm not from this first world. I don't have your first world problems, okay? Don't put me in this. Don't put me in this.
You know, what's actually interesting about that is, on the way over here to the station this morning, I was thinking very hard about the, well, we're going to talk a bit about it too, about the PLP's convention, right? I wasn't thinking very hard about that at all, actually, because that's kind of like thinking about the toilet flushing. Like, it's going to do the thing, unless something is preventing it from doing the thing. So it's just an inevitability. But I mean, in the sense that I thought about, first I'll say this. I've not been following Bahamian news, I think, for about a month now. I've essentially detached myself from it. To get myself in a headspace, because I have some things I need to do before December 15th. But not just that, I went back in and I looked at Bahamian news again, and I felt incredibly depressed, to be quite honest. It is almost as if someone hit a pause button, at least for me, hit a pause button, and then, like, the instant I started looking again, unpause, and it's like virtually nothing has changed. nothing at all. And I felt a sense of, you know, they call it again, circling the drain. Like, yeah. Like, where's the actual progress in virtually anything that we're doing in the country? Why are we still debating certain issues? I think I saw a news story yesterday that says, from our news, actually, that said that the two issues are coming up at the PLP's convention, and that is marital rape and marijuana. I don't know if they actually...
You again.
Yeah, so
you,
I was like...
Oh, Lord.
I was confused, because I said, we just did private public consultation. It wasn't open to the general public on two of these issues already. I know for a fact the legislation was already drawn up on marijuana. Actually, they had the closed sessions... Can I say that? I guess I can say that. At the University of the Bahamas as well. And I met some of the people who came out of it. I spoke to them. So I was just confused. What do you mean you don't have a stance on these things yet? Like, you were... legislation's already... You already paid for legislation to be drafted. Like, this is getting to the point where you're just going towards general public consultation and then voting on legislation. I was just confused by that. And then I just remembered to myself, that's right, for the Bahamas. We don't necessarily figure these things out before we get an office. We kind of get an office and then wiggle around, do one or two things, and then get voted out. And it's like, oh, we're still doing this, huh? So I don't know what to expect, because we know we're going to do a year in recap in December to go over the things that have and have not happened this year, and then things to look forward to next year. But you know, it's been, I don't know if that's been any of your experiences, like if you've been like paying attention to Bahamian news and you feel a sense of What is actually and factually new? And I suppose the challenge to the chairman of the Progressive Liberal Party, which I think the person at the moment, I know the person at the moment is Fred Mitchell, was successful in holding a seat. The race was a lot closer than I thought it was going to be when I saw the results.
Yes.
I thought of it as a foregone conclusion. And just to be fair, I have no particular... I'm not discriminating particularly against the Progressive Liberal Party. So if you are a PLP and you're listening, I don't care if you're a PLP or not. It doesn't make any difference to me. I am critical, and we are critical, and we critique all of them, including on whatever happened to the DNA, and I don't understand what's going on with the Coalition of Independence. I'm sure they know what's going on eventually. Maybe. I don't know. So I was going to say, Tate and Alea, I wasn't surprised by the results at all. I don't pay much attention to the internal squabbles within the parties. I do find it very interesting, though, when you have deep-seated positions like leader of the party, and sometimes even chairman, dislodging that person. I'm not sure if that's ever happened in Bahamian history before within those parties, at least within my lifetime, which would be in the last 30 years. I'm not sure that's ever happened. I know the value system of the party is one of loyalty and essentially seniority, and that if you've been in a certain position a certain amount of time, And you have, or if you haven't, you have to sit small until the name call, right? Yeah. At least that's what they say. I don't think that's very reflective of a democracy, but that's how the thing is operated. That's how the thing will always operate. I don't know. What are you guys? What are your guys' thoughts on that?
So for me, I will say, like you, I don't really have a care for PLP politics or policies on the whole, but I was shocked at the margin by which Fred won. I thought it was going to be like the Alfred Says and Perry Christie.
1,100 to 100 and some votes, yeah.
Yes, yeah. Well, Alfred Says got blown under the water by Perry Christie. But I think he only, Fred Mitchell only won by about, I think, 214 or 215 mm-hmm. votes. I think it was like 844 to 630 or something like mm-hmm. that. So I will say that I was very proud of what Robin Lange was able to achieve. And I was happy to see that. I hope that in the near future, I think there's going to be another convention before the election, if I heard correctly. I think she should put a hat in the race once again. Who knows what Fred's stature will be at the end of these 2 years. So I was very proud of that. But I think, like you said, the fact still remains within the PLP is that they have this very strange culture. I think it's also kind of demoralizing in some sense where essentially, like, sit small to your name call. You're supposed to be, you're supposed to wait your turn. I think that's a better term. And I just find it to be very strange. And I don't like that type of culture where, you know, you have to wait until your turn or wait until you're called to do so. That doesn't seem to be very democratic to me. It seems as though there are these invisible hands that control everything. Within the party, which I think is very strange. But nonetheless, I would say that I'm proud of Robin Lyons, and I would like to see her run again in the future. Yeah.
Ale, any input, Ale?
No, that was so comprehensive and so well thought out. Like, I absolutely love Tate's analysis of it. I'm in a funny spot right now.
Oh, I understand. I understand.
For obvious reasons, right? But, yeah. I hats off, like I said, and well, like Tate said, I agree. I would like to see more. I would love to see from the PLP, like just generally, I would love if they can name of being more progressive. I know that's a tough ask living in this, as Donald Trump once described it, a certain type of country. But they, you know, I'm just over it. I'm like, I'm so detached from Bahamian politics emotionally, or at least that I'm always disappointed, but I'm never surprised anymore. And so, like, I am just at a spot where nothing that they do, or nothing, and this goes for all both main parties, right? Nothing that's done anymore surprises me. It's the same garbage again and again. It's nothing new, no new tactics. Like, we still got the people still talking about the money and the shirts and the turkeys and ding, you know. Instead, they tried to, you know, switch it up a little bit, like a PS5 or something. Like, we in the modern day and age, you know, like, inflation is real. You can't just keep giving people, you know what I mean? Like,
nitrate, boy.
You know what I mean? Like, do a little something new. But I'm just so over, like, the same thing, the same faces again and again. I'm over, and I think this is just something in general, right, that a lot of people have problems with everywhere, that old people do not want to let go. I need the old people of this country who are deeply invested in politics, I need y'all to log off. I need y'all to go and find the closest rocking chair, find you a piece of wood or some yarn, and I need you to get to work. I need you to start wood carving and knitting. I need you to do something else other than what you're doing now, because the politics of yesteryear is not gonna fly. And like, it's a different generation now too, where people are not gonna, we're not standing by. We're gonna call you out. We're gonna call you out, and we're gonna make you uncomfortable with what you're doing, and no place is off limits. Like, no place. Younger Bahamian people are actually not as, I'm waiting to see, as I always tell Tate and Natino, I'm always waiting to see when things will pop off for Gen Z in particular. Like, what's going to be the tipping point for when we really start getting this party started? Because it's exhausting and it's disappointing, and they refuse to let power go. And so I just, like, what will it take for them to stop, realize they've been doing foolishness for 9 billion years and their hands won't get any wrinklier, and, you know, realize that they have to let go of the power that they want so bad?
I have an observation I had, right? Because I think Tate briefly spoke about this. The by-election that we're going to have in, what's the constituency's name now? West End and Bimini. The former seat of Cabinet Minister Obi Wilchcombe. I must say, probably perhaps because I've become very detached within the last 2 years from the nature of Bahamian politics, right? And as you travel the Bahamas, as I traveled a bit more of the Bahamas, I started to change my perspectives entirely about what politics actually mean for the country. As I read more literature, my perspective has entirely changed, especially towards the Famiyans. And it's not negative. I love the Famiyans, but I also understand that they're chronically underdeveloped, underpopulated, extraordinarily poor infrastructure. And for lack of a better term, driving through a lot of settlements in the Famiyans is like driving through the Rust Belt of the United States. It's like you could obviously see that there was wealth once upon a time. There was... life was teething and booming in those areas, and people obviously were working to build something better for themselves and their family. And then something just abruptly came in as like a specter in the night and killed all of it. And you go through a lot of those Famiyana sediments, and it's depressing. It's like everything is, not everything, but most things are run down. You'd be lucky if you have a government clinic there and the roof isn't caved in, or a police station where windows aren't busted out. It looks poor, for lack of a better term. And I'm specifically talking to government infrastructure. You could go on Harbor Island, and if it's a government building, it's likely going to have the roof caved in. It's like, it's such an expected feature. Everybody, when I spoke to about the island, was just like, yeah, that's just how it is. Government don't really care. So we don't care either. And and I'm not knocking any of those people. But when we have these conversations about elected officials running in these areas, and I hear the word change, I often have to ask, what are you going to change? What power do you have to change anything? To what, fill some potholes? That's much needed, obviously. But outside of that, what are you actually going to do? Because your job predominantly, according to the Constitution, well, the entirety of it, is to legislate. You're to vote, debate on legislation, government policy. I can't recall a single time that I've been alive and paid attention to Bahamian politics, I've actually seen a massive turnaround for a constituency, ever. So this conversation about what this candidate's going to do to change this, I think it's the wrong conversation to have. I think you should, this is my opinion, I think you instead should focus on what legislative changes you want to see in the Bahamas. Like, for instance, if you support the legalization and decriminalization of cannabis in the country, that should be a ticket issue that you raise with the candidate. That you, like, do you support this or do you not? I want you to support this. I want, when you go into House of Assembly, this is an issue. Abortion, whether you disagree or agree. Issues of land ownership. Should we change the law on land ownership and that certain areas should be reserved for Bahamians? But we don't have these conversations in the Bahamas. We're still on this rudimentary, for lack of a better term, stupid, very stupid wave based on a lot of the discussion I've seen on social media, and that's between Facebook and Twitter and a little bit of Instagram. I'm just like, I have no faith at all. I'm not trying to be negative either. I just have zero confidence and faith in my generation, which is millennials, or Gen Z, to be quite honest. And nothing against anybody. Well, actually, a lot against everybody. They're not interested in any of those things. No one cares. It's like the 14 of us that talk about these issues are the only ones that ever talk about them. But the general population of our country has virtually no issue with the status quo being the way that it is. No issue with the standard of your living continuing to plummet. You know what it feels like, Alea? It feels like being in an insane, not an insane asylum, for lack of a better term, probably the Matrix, right? And the leaders of the country, just like the writers of the Matrix, sometimes wear dresses, sometimes wear pants. I'm not sure all the time. Sometimes you call them trans, sometimes you call them women or men. Who knows? Whatever is your perspective. But it's like, it's a confusing, contradictory, incongruent status quo within the country. And to have any sensible political debate is virtually impossible, which is why we see the absolute attention that people like Lincoln Bain are getting, of people criticizing his submission and saying he's worth $1.8 million. I don't know if the man is or isn't. There's really no way to verify those things. Like, it honestly feels like this is just a circus, a clown show, for lack of a better term. And I guess come back in the next 50 years when the Bahamas is actually trying to be serious about its development. I don't know. What are you guys' perspectives?
You see, I always had the question, and I think about that, right? Like the future of this place. But given climate change, my concern is always, do we have enough time to solve all these issues?
I hope we don't. So Jesus, send the floods.
But I really do think that in order for us to like actually make a difference, some people have to go. Like they have to be removed from power, possibly or whatever way that we can. They have to simply go. They can't remain key pillars of our economy and the key pillars of our society for us to continue down the road, or for us to go where we want to go. Some people just have to go. And I think once we get those people gone, and once we kind of like, what is the word, change some fundamental aspects of our culture, and certain things, I think we can do better as a country. But I do agree with the fact that it does feel like a cycle. You know, we're doing things and hoping a different outcome with the same people. So I don't know. It feels like insanity. It feels like mania at some points. But I know for you, Don, and for me, it's just sarcasm to get over it because none of it makes sense. So, yeah.
I someone sent me a message. I can't read that. We got a text I want to read. I know exactly who this is from, but I won't say. This person said, like, you can text it at 422-GR96. It's 422-4796. It said, y'all don't want to join the conversation to push for decentralized government and more autonomy for our islands and communities, not constituencies. Where in the world is there a country with the model that we have that produces thriving communities outside of the capital city? You know what, texter? You're right. When you're right, anyway. I agree with you. Absolutely. I don't think anybody on the show would disagree that local government isn't like obvious low hanging fruit.
I mean, I think that conversation for local government is one that's been done countless times on this show, if I remember correctly.
Yes, I want there to be local government, and I know the next line I'm going to say and how this exact person is going to respond to me saying that. So I'll be positive. I want there to be local government, obviously, because the way that we operate in this, what's a nice way of saying this? In this sham of a Westminster system, I don't see change as something that is possible. And like we don't even have something consistent known as government policy. It's rules for thee, but not for me. Rules for you because you poor, and that's it. And you just have this great disparity. I think we just had a call. You can call back at 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or 325-4316. Or 325-4259. Some text just pouring in. Says, good morning, guys. Does the chairman get another salary for his party? Meaning the PLP, Ministers of Parliament. That's three salaries. Maybe he has been spoiled by money and is also power struck. It's interesting. I don't know if the chairman is paid. If it is a chairman position, then yes. Also interesting, in most Westminster countries that follow that system, at least that adhere to its rules, you cannot have a substantive cabinet position while also being chairman or hold leadership positions within a political party. Actually, most of the time, they give them basically placeholder cabinet positions that have no portfolio or real power to do anything. and they're separated from the cabinet process. At least that's the case in the United Kingdom. I think sometimes they could be like Secretary of the Exchequer or Undersecretary or something of the sort, but usually their hands are off of policy and voting on issues of law. Well, not really law, because they still legislate. But in the cabinet process, they're not allowed to be a part of it. And it's obviously to wash away the influence of politics within these decisions that we all know is obviously deeply entrenched in them. We don't practice that in the Bahamas. You could pretty much be leader of the party and no matter in this country. Most things don't. We say that we follow the system, but yet we just, like, Hubert Minnis should not be in House of Assembly. He should have been resigned and retired. He lost the election. Christie should have never ran again. After he lost that first election, he should have essentially fallen on his sword and retired. Same thing with Pindling. So I don't understand why we say we follow the system, because we don't. And anyway, moving on. We have another text. Says, can your producer please answer the phone? Our wonderful producer is definitely doing her job. Is this a lot happening at the moment? Mm. But again, if you want to text us in, you can text us in at 422-4796. That's 422-4796. So you can call us in at 323-6232 or 325-431 absolutely 6. Another thing has actually popped up in the news again this week, guys, that I wanted to discuss because an interesting development came about it. And that is the case involving the water and sewage former executive chairman, Adrian Gibson. The press is not gagged, to my understanding, on speaking.
That's a good thing.
I know. So that's why I think details have been slowly but surely
coming
out on that. Yeah. And I find it absolutely, what's a nice way of saying this?
Bonkers?
Degenerate is the words that I wanted to use, but I'm not going to attribute those words to anybody. I was just going to say the entire ordeal is just...
It's degenerate, is what you would say.
Yes, the fact that we're in this position in the first place is ridiculous to me. And the awarding of contracts to people that are your next of kin, your children... I think the word I want to use, and I'm sure Leia can understand this. Leia, did you ever watch The Godfather?
Yes.
Did you watch Part 1 and 2?
Yes.
That is how my interpretation of our political parties are. They are...
Yes.
Yeah, like if you were to put a logo for all the political parties, it would be like the... I can't remember the name. The thing of is it ventriloquist? The strings attached to the pieces of wood that control the dolls. Mm-hmm.
Marionettes.
That's what it is. Marionettes. That's what it feels like. Reading the details of this is just the whole headline of Petty's daughter had water and sewage contract, and then you just I'm trying to be positive here now.
So I have a question, right?
Go ahead.
So it was Gibson's defense that had subpoenaed Petty, right? Is that the case?
It says, during the first day of testimony in the corruption trial with Long Island MP Adrian Gibson, it was revealed that the daughter of Water and Sewage Corporation executive chairman, I can't pronounce his first name.
Sylvanus.
Sylvanus Petty, has a contract value of $26,000 with the corporation. Gibson, the former chair of the Water Sewage Corporation, and five others are on trial. Justice General Grant Thompson, Petty. I'm not sure, Tate. I'm going to check through some more of this, but you did have a point I'm sure you wanted to raise about that.
Yeah, so, I mean, I'm thinking if... And this case is going to be so interesting because I think we've already normalized what I call corruption. You know, you got to be careful with our words on the show. I don't want to get kicked off, but you already normalize what I view to be what I, in my opinion, view as corruption, right? So I do wonder if it is the case that Gibson's defense had requested that Petty testify. I do wonder if it's their strategy to normalize what we refer to as political patronage in the Bahamas. I wonder if that's their strategy to get him off. Because I was shocked to see that he was at the trial. I mean, my question is, why is Petty being asked to testify in the trial to talk about, you know, what he's doing with water sewage? And so it seems as though to me they're trying to normalize something, but I just don't know. Yeah, that's what it feels like to me.
Yeah.
Like they're trying to make sure this is okay and that Gibson is not guilty.
And before I lay up,
I want to go in. Okay, go I do want to go in just because I want to compare. So, because I got some receipts here. So, 2021, right? We got the chairman at the time, the chairman. So, Petty had said that they were examining the contracts and it's going to be their priority, right? He said that we're going to operate with transparency as well. There wouldn't be any shady stuff going on as well. And one person making a decision. Like I said, we now have a board in place along with the executives. And then in the questioning, like you mentioned, I'm not a fan. I can't lie. The back and forth that the Guardian had reported on, right? I'm not really sure I like the line of questioning. Maybe that's just me. Like, I feel like it's a little weird. I do agree that they're trying to normalize it. I think Petty has a point. Like, he's right. Like, the Bahamas is kind of how things work here. And I, being from my experience, I don't know if he's telling the truth or not, right? I don't know the truth. We don't know, right? But that is something that happens in government here, where the depending on the amount of the contract, you don't get to know. It will not come to your desk. It literally won't come to your desk. It'll get approved by somebody else in a much smaller position than you, just because the company is capable or whatever have you, right? And it literally, they will not know. The minister will never know because it's not relevant to them. The minister's staff, the minister's executive level staff is responsible for briefing the minister on the happenings that's going on in their ministry. And so there's going to be a lot of stuff, respectfully, and I think it's for the Bahamian public as well. There's a lot of things that ministers do not know that happens within their ministry or their portfolio that they never encounter. They never find out.
Like the BPL hedging facility? Like when they said that they never saw the email for that? For the
boy, facility. Ouch.
Continue, though.
But it's true. It is not like no funny stuff. Seriously, it is something that happens. Like I'm speaking from experience here that people genuinely will not tell. And sometimes, in many cases, people, depending on who's in, because people in the ministries or in these positions also have loyalties to different parties, which is something that needs to be tackled. So there have been times in government where people will sabotage the minister at the time, depending on the party, to prevent them from, or they will purposefully hinder the minister from knowing something. And I've overheard a high-level executive before saying this about a minister, oh, well, the minister always shoots down my ideas, or this person always shoots down my ideas, so I can't bring it to them in this way. We have to go around or something like that. You know what I mean? So that is something that really happens, where they will intentionally either go around the minister, they will hide something from the minister, or they just won't bring it up because they don't feel like the minister should know. They want to sabotage, or maybe they just don't want the minister to have any knowledge that they're doing wrongdoing.
You know what sucks about all this? People doing this, like, for less than 100K, less than 50K. Like, competing with their co-workers for garbage salary, and it's so shameful.
Interestingly, on Leia's point, so I read another part of the story. It says that Petty, maybe we'll go a little further up. It says, Petty, who is a member of Parliament for North Eleuthera and Deputy Speaker of the House of Assembly, said he does not, he doesn't know because everybody in the Bahamas is family. So nepotism is not something that you frown on. That's what Gomez asked him. Petty responded by saying, no, sir. Gomez asked, what about political allies? Petty said he has no issue as long as the company is capable. He added that the board votes on contracts and the vote must be unanimous. Gomez said, have you ever voted for a contract for your daughter, son, or close family member? Petty said, none of my family ever came to the board for a contract for us to vote on. Gomez asked, do you know... I can't pronounce the name. I think it's Selethia Gruzeski, or is it Gruzeski? Okay, just I'm gonna put SG because I can't pronounce the name. Petty said he did. It was asked by Gomez, "Is she your daughter?" Which he responded, "Yes." And Gomez asked if she is involved in a company called Manscaped Maintenance. Petty said that has never come before the board. There are smaller contracts that don't come before the board. So it kind of lines up with what you were saying, Alea. I think, of course, now this is not going to be the case. Well, I'm saying that as if the law matters in this country, right? It shouldn't be the case anymore that you are unaware or that the public is unaware, because a lot of these things are supposed to be going up on bonfire, especially a contract valued, I think it's what, $10,000 and up? Or was it $5,000 and up? One of those. This is the threshold is much lower. They're supposed to be publicly displayed, or at least supposed to. I'm saying supposed to be because, you know, a lot of things supposed to happen, but you know, like we're not supposed to have potholes, they're supposed to get filled, you know. It's funny anyway. So I don't know. I think we're going to see more of this in the future, so I guess get over it, you know. Nepotism, and it's not a real issue in the Bahamas, you know what I'm saying, guys? Get over it. Stop complaining.
Oh my god,
move on. Nothing to see here. Same thing with the Leslie Miller situation with the contracts. We said it's not a sweetheart deal. I think it was last week. It's so, I guess I agree. We are a small nation, of course. There are a limited number of professionals, considering we also balkanize the professional landscape of the Bahamas. Every time there's an election cycle, we blackball one half and they can't get no contracts. And then only our people who are friendly with us can get it. And so we play a game I like to call, it's a great game. It's a great game, guys. I don't know if you ever heard it before. It's called Stupid, and that is how we govern. We split basically the professional pool of persons in this country in half, and some people refuse to participate in the game, and they just skip town altogether. And they just live in London, you know, and then they come back to the Bahamas when their particular party's in place, and they just go right back. People go to New York. I know somebody goes to Canada. So it's and I'm speaking of very specific people, nothing negative about them, but just saying this is what we've created and seem to see no problem with this. I take issue, obviously, with the issues of supposed nepotism. The optics of this are bad. This is probably why you want more transparency rather than less. I think if you also had things like local governments, you would anyway, whatever. Let me move on. Anyway, we have a texter. Says, good morning, the eye-opener. Bahamians are quite content with the status quo. If they were to ever leave this country and go to Canada and see how backward this country is, the PLBF and him as well as the UBP cannot manage or govern Toronto. That city is light years ahead of this country, including Nassau. Jamaica, in some ways, are light years ahead of the Bahamas.
As much as I dislike Andrew Holness, I agree.
Oh, I despise Andrew Holness now.
Yeah.
India, a little bit, you know, like where they shucked and jived for the Israelis. And
we need to get into that.
Yeah,
that
we will. We will.
Peeve. Like, I have been so, oh my God, we need to touch on that. I'm so angry every time I hop on social media and see Indians shucking and jiving.
You know, it's
curried coons. I can say this as a black Indian person, right? As Kala Jat, I can absolutely say that because that's how I feel. Like, it's so embarrassing to me to be a person. There are pictures, dude. Like, there are pictures of Indian women being ridden by British soldiers like donkeys. And you literally sitting on Indian women's backs. And you are here today just betraying your ancestors and everything that our culture has stood for as resistors of imperialism. To stand with a group of people who are literally committing genocide, it's getting so embarrassing and so annoying seeing the solidarity between a very disenfranchised, I might add, and they're very, like, European, this European descendant community.
With the part about it that makes it so, and I spoke about Holness earlier, right, because he released a statement, I think shortly after the October 7th attacks, breaking away essentially from CARICOM, and he just was, anyway, he said some things that were basically just solidarity, and I was like, bro, they don't care. You're not even considered human to a lot of these people. I know this may come foreign to some people's ears. I remember vividly the Hurricane Dorian coverage of the Bahamas from CNN, MSNBC, Fox News. I cannot use the words. I have to be censored because I'm on radio. It was like, look at this African safari jungle Negro country that doesn't know how to do anything. And all of the writings they had of write-ups about the Bahamas, aside from the devastation that obviously took place with people, when they spoke of the Bahamas, it was extraordinarily disparaging. I saw the coverage. Oh, no. If you just looked at like CNN and MSNBC's and the rest of them's live feeds at the time when people, I remember the Fox News reporter saying that Abaco smelled like the Rwandan genocide, right? And I looked in the comment section, and it was just vitriol and racism against Bahamians. And I was shocked. And then I saw some news coverage also of, they had some overhead helicopter and drone shots of the houses that were destroyed in the mud, and also some of the devastation that took place in Grand Bahama. East End was obliterated for the most part. It was literally that... people were saying, I would say, let me not be specific, Americans, specifically white Americans, were saying the Bahamas should be grateful that the United States came to their aid. And I don't think for a second that Bahamians are not grateful for the U.S. Coast Guard and the U.S. government support that they gave us, right? Nobody is going, I don't think most Bahamians would disagree with that. However, it started to take a turn when they started to say that, oh, Bahamians don't know how to build homes. Why don't they just copy it? In mass. And when Bahamians jumped in and said that's not true, the Bahamian building code is similar to that of Florida.
Much stronger.
Oh, they were like, you can't talk to us like this because your country is dependent on tourism, and we'll just stop coming to the Bahamas because I feel very offended by the way that you're talking to me. And it was just nonstop, nonstop, all day is what I was seeing. And I was like, what the hell is this? And the thing is, I say this as I'm not hating on Americans either. I had friends who lived, well, one friend in particular who lived in Texas, who specifically organized, I don't want to live in Atlanta, organized mobilized the Bahamian community in Dallas, Texas, in the Fort Worth area, as well as in Atlanta. I have friends who live in Atlanta who organized also for Americans and other Bahamians and black people and white people, everybody, to give, they had a whole drive to give things to the Bahamas, such as food, water, clothes, all these things, these aid packages they gave us. So I don't get it twisted that I'm bad-mouthing anybody. I'm just saying it is quite clear, based on the media coverage, especially Western media, that they think of us as subhuman. And I say this to preface this conversation we're going to have. So when I saw Andrew Holness make his statement, and I saw it on Facebook, I was very curious to see how it was received globally. Mm-hmm. I can't use the language that was used, but it was essentially, why is this poor Negro talking? Is the essence of what I was getting. When I saw India take their stance and saying that, oh, we stand with Israel, I was like, I don't think this is a fight for you to get involved, bro. I'm not here defending people being slaughtered or killed on either side of this conflict, but I'm just saying. And I say this because shortly after that, now we now know this now because things have been leaked, that the Israeli government reached out to the Indian government shortly after they made their statement of solidarity, saying that they were getting rid of 100,000 Palestinians working inside, not Gaza, not the West Bank, in Israel. They were firing them and putting them back into their neighborhoods, more than likely to ethnically cleanse them. And they wanted to import 100,000 Indians to come and work in various menial labor jobs inside.
Absolutely. They want another oppressed underclass.
Yes.
They want another oppressed underclass. And that is what I need. Like, I need people of color to realize. Like, this false solidarity you have with people who literally do not care about you and literally want to see you suffer. I really wish Indians in the mainland could understand that they have been manipulated for quite some time by the same colonizers who our ancestors fought to get away from. And so here we are now with a band of blubbering buffoons who are anti, who are Hindu nationalists, who are embarrassing us on a global scale. We have, India is such a rich country, rich in people and culture and knowledge. And to see this now, like, it is just so exhausting. It's so depressing to me and so upsetting. I feel so angry as well. Like, when I think about how we are watching, there is not really much we can do. There is something we can do about it. But if I say, I don't know.
Well, where you in Tate live, you especially, you don't have freedom of speech where you live. So probably don't say anything. Neither you or Tate.
I'll post about that. That's something too. I'll post about the protests going on in London to keep people abreast. But I cannot attend because people get arrested there. Yeah. And so that's where we're at. And I mean, of course it's going to happen in the UK because the UK is one of the people who helped create Israel, right? People in the UK, and that's also something like I wish more people knew. I'm seeing that as well. We talked about it a little bit. But Bahamians, there are Bahamians who are trying to be in solidarity with Israel as well. It's getting weird, Pookie.
I think what's
not clicking? Like, what's not clicking?
The
like,
reason,
what's going on, Dar?
I agree with you. I think, and this isn't separating this away from the obvious optics of race. This is more along the lines of Western civilization and the global South, just period the global South. And if you thought otherwise, because I used to think otherwise too, I think Hurricane Dorian was a big slap in the face to wake me up from that. I used to think the Bahamas was considered quote unquote a Western nation, considering we
really wait, when did you think that? Oh my God.
I used to think that, right? Because technically, if you go by the definition of, and I quote, the West, most of the Caribbean, most of it, not all of it, most of it follows pretty much line for line those things. Especially the parliamentary democracy, quote unquote, freedom of speech, all this nonsense, right? And some of the same problems that we have are also present in quote unquote Western nations. But when you actually and factually have a crisis happen in your country and you see the press coverage, you are woefully awoken to the reality of what the perception of your country and your people is. And it is not that you are a part of this group. You are de facto global South, period.
Absolutely.
End of discussion. As our identity and our heritage and also our connections with the Caribbean, to say that, oh, we're not of the Caribbean, we're of North America. To us, perhaps, yes. And geographically, you can make that argument. But culturally, socially, economically, no, we are not. You are de facto global South. Whether or not you want to accept it, get over it. It is what it is. It's always been the case. And I say this also to say, if you take notice of the situation in Ukraine, and you paid attention to the countries that outright... Now, of course, I think the Bahamas also voted to say that these things are wrong. I don't think most right-thinking people are going to say, yeah, go invade that country and kill all those people. But when they had the conversations about sanctions and doing mass condemnations, a lot of the global South was absolutely stone silent. Few who have a little bit more economic independence actually said something, but most of us were silent. Sometimes we would vote in favor of different resolutions, or I think one condemnation, but then they got vetoed anyway. But it's usually because of our interest to try and stay alive, especially the Bahamas. Like, I don't understand why we voted for regime change in Venezuela, in the Organization for American States. But similar proposals have come across our desk in reference to that situation in Ukraine. And again, like I said, a lot of the global South was stone silent on the issue. Some, right, took the side of Russia. Some took no sides at all. They said, we want peace because, you know, we want to buy grain. And we don't want the oil market to be disrupted with these sanctions because then it's going to cost more for us for electricity. So we find ourselves in these situations where bad policy of Western countries leads to these conflicts in the first place. And the people who pay disproportionately for it are those of the global South. If you wonder why your gas bill, when you go to the gas station, gas is so expensive, You're paying for these conflicts, for lack of a better term. I don't know what's going to happen as a result of this conflict, but I also wanted to say it was brazenly clear how this world is divided based on this conflict. And I hate the fact that it took something like this to show this. I wish it was a peaceful situation and showed people this demarcation and separation. But the language that used to describe countries that include us by Israel is essentially countries that lack democracy, countries that support barbarism, countries that are basically savages fighting out in the wilderness, nations of animals.
Children of darkness.
Yes.
This is what we are.
And that's not my opinion of me saying that that's what I think they said. That is what de facto has been said.
Yeah.
And the people supporting them saying these things are the United States, is Canada, is most of West, the entirety just about of Western Europe, sparing Ireland and bits and pieces of Spain. And I see Belgium is starting to move in the direction of talking about sanctions. But I bring this up to say, it's like the same thing I witnessed within my borders in the Island House and had a few. Right. And the gentleman accosted me the way that he did. And the tinge in his voice and the way that he said things was as though you can't say nothing to me because you dark and you know where you is in this country. And if I call the police on you, you know what gonna happen to you. And I knew exactly why he felt so confident to say the things that he said to me at that particular point in time, because I knew the situation that I found myself in. It should not be that way in my own flipping country, but it is. And on the international stage, when we have these conversations and you see the shucking and jiving, it's like Alea, like you said, it's very confusing. Like, what are you doing? You are not one of them. They will never accept you. And it's quite blatant looking at the responses of some even Israeli officials in reference to India. It's like, they do not see you as human. They see you as...
They never saw us as human.
Yes.
I know we don't want to say that it's like that it's racially motivated, but like the adjectives you use, barbaric, right? Savage.
Animals.
Those are all, right, animals. Those are all racially charged things. Those are racially charged words that have always been historically used to describe colors, communities of color. And those words, like the British and the Spanish and the Portuguese and the Dutch, and the Americans, they've consistently used those words to justify colonizing our countries and plundering them and raping them and pillaging them and making them territories. Because they don't think, as people of color, that we're intelligent enough to even run our own stuff. It's maddening, but at this point, it'll take one thing and one thing only, I think, to really get it. For people to really understand from the rest, the West. I'm trying to find the right words, like you said. You know, there's no freedom of speech in this country.
No, there isn't.
States country, right? But that's where we're at. We're at a point where you have to pull a Thomas Sankara, you have to pull a Fidel Castro and a Che Guevara, because, or a Mao Zedong or a Ho Chi Minh, right? Because at this point, the West doesn't understand any other form of conversation except in the form of violence.
It's very unfortunate that we're here.
It's unfortunate, but that's what Western culture is. That's what, I dare say, that's what white culture is, because white culture is Western, right? I dare say that is what Western culture is. Western culture is to pillage and discriminate and... You know, Western culture requires that kind of like hierarchical structure that I think a lot of Bahamians have really latched on to because of how we've watched the U.S. and how we've gotten ourselves sucked into those like Christian hyper
religious. No, we've sucked. You said it right the first time. We've sucked. We've sucked all that in.
we've sucked. Actually, we've more than sucked. Eh? We get bullied by the U.S. To be quite honest, we've been historically bullied by the U.S.
It's actually alarming that you say it like that. It's alarming because.
But it's true, eh?
No, it is true. I don't disagree. It's like the wholesale importation of a lot of these ideas, like this ultra conservatism the Bahamas has today. I'm always flabbergasted and confused when Bahamian's older than myself. I hate saying that. When older Bahamians, so people that I know that are much older, tell me that this country wasn't always like this. Tell me that this country, once upon a time, was very... We thought you did not see mass groupthink in the Bahamas. And that sounds so foreign to me because a lot of the public discourse around issues tends to be so incredibly vapid and stupid. I cannot possibly envision a world where the Bahamas isn't the way that it is right now, at least to me, because I've never seen anything different. But they tell me all the time that, no, a lot of the issues and positions that we debate on were not the way that we were talking about them in the past. And in fact, that there was more... Go ahead, Tate.
No. Go. I was going to say, I'm just saying, I don't know if I can believe...
This is what I say, too. I don't know if I truly can accept... Because it's like... prime example. Let me calm down a bit. We have currently an administration that has pledged to have, well, a pledge, has a legislative agenda and pledged to fulfill that legislative agenda that includes the decriminalization and legalization of medicinal cannabis, that includes changing, this is their words, not mine, changing this paradigm, this law on marital rape, addressing the issues of the age of consent. And we're still in 2023. Where we now, 2 years into their term, they're still coming up with positions on these issues.
Right.
It's like, I know, Alea, you said that a lot of Western, especially global North countries, have perceived us as being incapable of running our own countries. Sometimes I have to question that myself, in that, can we actually? Because... The national conversation and debate and those from our leaders is so stupid. I feel like when you eat ice cream or you have like a slush, and like you take in too much of it, and then like the ice starts to top your mouth and you get brain freeze. That's how I feel. I feel brain freeze. Why are we so dumb? Why are we still doing these things? Why has nothing changed? Why are we still debating the exact same issues 50 years later? Why are we so paralyzed to change it? Why can't we have a proper busing system, not just in New Providence, even on the Farm Islands? I've had people come on the show and tell me after the show, the Farm Islands don't need public transportation, which is ridiculous to me, considering the fact that every Farm Island you go to, there's people hitching rides all over the place. It's like, right, we are so comfortable and prepared, especially in New Providence, because people in the Farm Islands tend to have different perspectives. But especially in New Providence, we are so comfortable with the backwardness of our nation, with the regressiveness, and we aggressively pursue regressive and stupid policies that do more to harm Bahamians. Like the fact that the government of the Bahamas approved a hotel, well, whatever that thing is, because there's residences in them as well, approved a hotel on the Cable Beach Strip in front of the Prime Minister's office that did not have adequate parking. Right? The win is winning right now. You know why? Because they get free parking by parking at the beach. That's supposed to be available for the public. But you see the government saying anything about this? No.
Nope.
I think, like how America is the land of the free and the home of the brave, we are the land of the conch. And the home of the conch salad.
We are the land of the conchs. Like, we are Alijah Gittes personified. I think we're giving them far little credit. I think a lot of times you'll find that the ruling class, they know what they're doing, but they're either getting a slice of the pie, or maybe somebody that they know is getting a slice of the pie, or maybe they just don't care because, you know, why should they care? You know what I mean? Why care when you have all your money? It's the regular people who are suffering, right? Mind you, you know, I'm personally be very scared to slip up if I was in government, because, you know, my first thought is, I always think of the French Revolution. And I think a lot of people don't really, a lot of ruling class and Western people, they think that they're untouchable. But when you put people in a desperate position, and you really push them to their limit, you cannot be surprised at the lengths that they will go in the future to watch you and your family suffer. Mm-hmm. And so I, like, that is something I think about that quite often, because that's why I said earlier, like, I really do wonder what it'll take, because it's going to take something, and something, we're getting to that point. for Palestine to be in this mess due to white supremacy and to, you know, Europe's own anti-Semitism problem that's their culture, really, because they've been doing that for hundreds of years, right? That, I don't know, man. I'm over it. I'm just done. Like, the worldwide support for Palestine versus, like, the governmental support. So it's kind of going hand in hand with what you said, Dawn. Like, the people will want one thing. The government, the elected officials will want another. But they'll be campaigning off of these same tired issues again and again. It's foolishness.
I would say, though, that... No, I have nothing positive to add to that. But I will pivot on that and say, there is hope. I don't know what's going on with phone lines at the moment. I think I touched something and everything's turning red. So you know, like when you like, it's doing okay. Moving on. So yeah, you could text us in because some phone lines are doing a thing at 422-4796. That's 422-GR96. If you have anything to add to the conversation, I wanted to say, I got a text. I can't read that text. People, stop sending me spicy things. You know, like, I want to read everybody's messages, but if you're going to send me a private message, please make sure it's not buried in things that I can't say or censor properly for radio. On this issue of essentially governance in the country, like, we spoke about the by-election coming up. We spoke about a little bit. We just touched on, because I don't want to dig too much into the one and two situation yet. I want more things to come out as this trial continues, because I have been sent. Oh, let me censor that. I've been privy to some things about it before the case actually came fully underway. And I'm very curious to see if those things are legitimate or those are just fake news, right? Some of the things are starting to line up, but I want to see how the case progresses to see what happens. I'm extraordinarily curious. It feels like, not just curious of what will come up, but what will happen at the end of this. Cause how many charges does it take? Like 90 something, 98 charges, something.
Yeah. 98 charges. Yeah.
Yeah. And it makes me wonder about those charges because, you know, we actually don't do consecutive sentencing. So if you are found guilty of multiple counts, and the highest count is 7, the most you'll serve is 7 years, which isn't really 7 years in Bahamian prison years.
Yeah.
And then you may get let a little earlier. So it's a bunch of technicalities in there. So, but I'm very eager to see how this case pans out. I think it has the potential to set precedent, because it seems now, ever since the Minnis administration charged the likes of Ken Dorsett and pursued all those cases against former cabinet minister in the Liberal Party from the last Christie administration, that every single time the government changes, charges may be brought up, which I suppose is a positive development in the country. Like, you're moving to some semblance of accountability, although unfortunately nothing ever comes out of these cases. It's a giant waste of money. And we also end up paying out these people that total millions of dollars for wrongful prosecution, and it's not even just a slap in the face. It is just absolutely hilarious when you think about the countless young men in this country that are charged on bogus charges and are beaten into submission for confessions, and or in instances never even see their time in court. They just languish in jail for years, and then eventually just get released because some lawyer decided to take on the case pro bono because they thought it was a massive constitutional breach. And then they sue the government for maybe $26,000 and hopefully get something, or you get punched in your mouth from the Royal Bahamas Police Force. And then it's almost like it's a caste system in a way. I know that's a very strong charge for me to levy, but if you look at the quote unquote damages that are awarded to private citizens who don't have millions of dollars, have not been in the public eye for politics for decades or from two terms or more, and the payouts they get from abuses of the system in this country versus the payouts that those who are of political backgrounds get, it's like night and day. It's like 10% or less is what you're going to get if you're lucky. It isn't really worth much in this country either. So it's my question, I guess I have to ask is, when do we cast away these things? When do we decide that enough is enough? This has to change. This is just let's just change the law on these things. Let's make this an equitable system, equal for all. Opportunity should be equal for all. Or do we just continue this route until the Bahamas is underwater? What do you guys think?
So, I mean,
that's a deep question, I know.
It's a very deep question. I tired of being pessimistic, but you know, that's just my nature. But I do think that I don't know if we'll get to that point. Can you all still hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. No, we can hear you.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. I don't know if we'll ever get to that point. I don't know if we can. I don't know. I mean, COVID-19 was a unifying moment for us. We've had plenty of unifying moments or unifying narratives where we could have changed it as a country. We could have done it in Dorian. They messed up in Dorian. We could have done it in the COVID-19 pandemic. We messed up then. I mean, everybody messed up. But that isn't to say that we can't cast blame. I think, though, we could have done some things differently. But I think we're at a point now where everything for me is still symbolism. And when I say that, I mean as though we want to appear as though we're being progressive in certain ways. But when you look at the policies and when you look at what is being enacted on our behalf, these policies they're only liberal. They're not progressive. They're only symbolic, mm-hmm. right? And I'm specifically talking about the marijuana law, right? And so I don't know if we get that point. And looking at the younger generation, we said that we should have hope in them, but I don't even have hope in some of them, to be honest. Not the mainstream one. This, I mean, they're following in the footsteps of the people that they admire. So I don't know if we'd have the time to change. I can't say. I mean, I want us to change. I want us to be better as a people, but we just ain't getting it. We just aren't. And I fear as though when we get to that point of, if we ever get to the point of us finally seeing that what is wrong with us and that we are failing as a country, I think it'll be too late. So we'll see. I don't know what's going to happen. I think it's business as usual. And it'll be too late for us to change. So that's my opinion.
I don't know. Right. I don't know if I'd say, Lee, you had something to add?
I don't know. I mean, I think you might be onto something. I was hearing you start to speak. I think I agree with you that it's starting. Like, I think there's hope. I want to say there's hope, right? But at the same time, boy, I know it's little rough. I mean, so we've just been in this cycle for so long that it's just, where do we go? And I think what Tate is getting at in particular is that people are being groomed. They've been groomed, right? This is politics. People are always groomed for this sort of stuff, right? So we have younger, for example, we have like senators and stuff who have been groomed in the party. They've been parties and then they move on to the senators and eventually da-da-da in different positions. And then they're probably going to run to become an MP. This cycle has got to change. And honestly, I'm at a point where I'm getting real tired. I'm already a part of a disenfranchised underclass, right? But a disenfranchised underclass that is being more and more not only radicalized to the left, but also more and more educated and exposed.
I don't know.
What happened in Tate to resolve this is you got to strike fear in these people's eyes. People ain't scared no more. That's what it is.
Yeah.
People used to be scared. We need to bring back shame. And we need to bring back fear. We need to bring back fear. Fear of the government. Fear that the government has fear of its own people. A government and government officials should always fear the people that they serve, in my opinion. They should respect them, and they should fear them. If you want to have another term, you should work your butt off. But they're not going to do that because there's no penalty for that. And that's the problem. That's what we're in right now. Because, and I mean, look at Perry. People complain about him all the time. But my boy had, you know, he's in this Yao Ming era. He got the Chinese thing on. You know, he's rocking that right now.
He got the Hillary Clinton going on. He's doing the Hillary Clinton pantsuit.
He got the little
Scooby-Doo on. What he looks like, he's been dressing a lot like Benny Hinn. You remember how Benny Hinn used to wear those?
Screaming. But you know what I'm saying? Like, my boy is like, he is cooked. He's already done what he got to do. You know what I mean? And the only time he had a penalty, he completely, his hope was crushed. And he was like, all right, I go on then. So that's really how it, like, that's how it has to be. You have to strike fear into these people's hearts. They have to have fear. And it can't just be fair that they won't get re- because that doesn't mean anything to them when they have money and resources, you know what I mean? And they're power adjacent. So they can come out of office and still be straight because what, them boy in power still.
So I want to say something, the response, another response, kind of adding on to what you were saying, but I think the picture is a little bleaker than you think it is. You said that we're getting educated. No, no. The stats point to a very, very negative reality that we're facing in the Bahamas. Women disproportionately are, in fact, getting educated, getting college degrees, advanced degrees, certifications, I think about 3 to 4 times the rate that men are. And it's accelerating, right? So if you go at the University of the Bahamas' campus, when I was a student there, when I was college at Bahamas, of course, it was, I think the ratio was like 1 to 4. I think the ratio, it's definitely gotten worse. Particular majors now, interesting, you see more women inside engineering. I have no problem with that either. But you're seeing a lack of engagement of men, period, in academia. And I know people are saying, well, you don't need to get a college degree. I 110% agree with you. You do not need to get a college degree. I actually think that you should, of course, have some form of training, have a trade, go to vocational school, especially BTVI. I'm not sure if BTVI is still covered under the tertiary grant. I think that it is. Go get a trade. Go be an electrician, a carpenter, and they're making bank. Eventually get your own business, become a contractor. Do what you got to do. Like, make your money. But at the same time, I don't see, based on them stats that came out from that, the preliminary stats, I should say, from that census, I'm sure, Tate, you it creates another problem. We're not having enough children. And judging by the conversation, go ahead, Tate.
And people are leaving at an alarming rate, too.
Yes. A lot of educated people are running away from this country. Another problem is,
understandable.
I think it's about 26,000 something people who were added to the register. Well, not city register, added to the numbers of the Bahamas. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Tate. Maybe I may be speaking here. But from what I recall reading, were of migration. Is that correct, Tate? Because I know you read those results. Yes.
Yeah. So I think the comparisons between natural growth, like natural births, I think we grew like about probably like the 50,000 people in the last 10 years, I think it was, or whatever, right? But
half
of those were by like natural births, and the other was through migration. So people are coming here and Bahamians are leaving, right? But the migration is outpacing the natural births.
And who's having the natural births?
That's a good question.
You go by what just happened at the Shantytown conversation where
the
woman on the show on the next station essentially was shaming the lady for having 7 children and no job, and supposedly the father isn't involved in the life. That's not a one-off situation in this country. Here's another funny statistic that are going to come out of that, right? You go 20 years from now, if you could fast forward in time, if we're still not obliterated or defaulted on our loans, you will see, yes, that too, you will see more than likely that if let's say that woman has, for lack of a better term, 3.5 boys, 3.5 girls, the 3.5 girls are more likely to go to college and get a college degree than the boys. It is more likely that those boys, especially in that type of economic environment, and the socioeconomic situation that family may find themselves in the past, even if they're in high school, they'll have to find some way to bring in money for the house. And the stories I've heard from young men, I even had a student who wanted to drop out of college entirely because of the pressures family was putting on him to earn money. And it was strange because his sister had none of those pressures put on them. And it's like the way that we socialize children is very bizarre in this country. But anyway, so the reality you may find is that women will be obviously, and I think that's already the case in the Bahamas, far more equipped for a changing Bahamas that isn't actually changing at all, but more equipped to occupy managerial and leadership roles and positions within the Bahamas. I don't quite get why in political parties and parliament that hasn't reflected the reality that has already taken place in quasi-government institutions, banks, insurance companies. Like, it is, again, I'm not knocking anybody or saying that there's some great gender disparity, we got to stop these things from happening. I'm just saying you have an issue where what I'm getting at is we are manufacturing a poor working class of Bahamians. And the education system is not your saving grace to get out of the situation. We have grown poverty in the Bahamas, not reduced it. If you go on the Family Islands, just go on Eleuthera, for Christ's sake. And just drive. I didn't love Eleuthera. My wife's family is from Eleuthera. Nothing bad to say about Eleuthera, but I will tell the truth. You drive through Eleuthera, and you can see how depressed many of these settlements are. And the reality is, if a lot of the kids in the settlements stay there for their entire lives, statistically, they're more likely to be poor than if they leave. And I have students right now who I know at the University of the Bahamas, who 18, 19, 20, 21, who are from the Family Islands, Eleuthera, Exuma, one from Managua, Abaco, do not want to go home because ain't nothing for them to go home to. What we're in fact actually been doing is the men of our country are disproportionately less equipped to deal with the growing, I guess to say, disparity of have and have nots in this country. Women are more equipped to do so, which you would think would be a good thing, but then 70% of the households that have children in this country are to single mothers. So it's like, even if the father was in the situation, statistically, he ain't making no money. So the very foundations of what we would call this Christian nation's family structure is broken. And it didn't just get a break. I'm just saying it's going to get worse into the future. So you're going to see more flight from the Bahamas. And it's like, and I know I'm painting a negative picture. So we're coming with some solutions at the end of this, right? Because it's not going to be all dark. But what I'm getting at purely is we are manufacturing so many of our own problems. And I like that you talked about, Alea, the ruling class of this country kind of really don't care. And you're right. You know why? Because their children don't go to public school like y'all. Who your poor children have to go to public school? Because they children...
They go to King College.
They go to King's College. They go to Life for Kings. They go to QC. Sometimes they go to SAC. And SAC is kind of where you put them sometimes. And I know some SAC people are very upset for me to say that. But do not forget, you gave us minutes. Anyway, moving on.
That's true.
And then, it's like, have any of us stopped and thought for more than 10 minutes about the fact, because I think everybody on the show, Tate, did you come from private school as well?
Yes.
See, this is unfortunate, right? Did you come from private school as well, Aleo? I think you went to St. George's.
Yeah, I did.
Or is it Kingsway?
I went to Kingsway, unfortunately.
There's nothing wrong with going to Kingsway, but sure. I'm bringing this up to say, it is so obvious to you that the public education system, specifically in New Providence, is so bad that if you want to give your child a leg up more often than not, and if you can afford it, because everybody got the money to do so and it ain't cheap, you would put them in a private school to give them a better shot in this country and abroad than you would leaving them in the public school system, which is a damning condemnation to know that most of our politicians, especially the ones with means, have put their children through private education. When I was at Queen's College, I didn't know this until I graduated. I didn't realize how many politicians' kids were either in set with me or came just before or just after me. And seeing them in public and recognize me, I'm like, I didn't know that that was your dad. It's so weird, right? It's like, for lack of a better term, the game's rigged. That's what I'm getting at here. And to, I don't think we can simply just revolutionize our way out of this situation. And this is not unique to the Bahamas either. This is the same situation in Jamaica. I'm not too sure about Barbados. They kind of tripled down on education for quite some time and then absolutely abandoned it when they had a government administration that spent like the last Christie administration and ended up defaulting. So they've cut back a lot on that. But it's like this is a issue that duplicated itself all throughout the entirety of the Caribbean. And I bring this up predominantly, Alea, because how do you de facto build a country or improve upon your country when you have a system of education that students are in grade 12 and cannot write their names? And it was interesting to hear my wife talk about a circumstance where she had to interact with, I'm not going to call it class, and they struggled. I think it was 10, 11, and 12, and several of them struggled with writing their names. And to talk to a friend who had been a teacher in the past to say, oh, that was the thing from the early 90s, man. I was experiencing that from then. It's like, how long, man? So are we in this situation? Well, actually, we know the answer to this question. We're not in this situation because it's by accident. It just happened to us. We've manufactured the Bahamas to be the... What Trump say again?
Asshole?
Yeah, we've manufactured the country. Yes, the whole of it. The whole? That's it right there.
Yeah.
We created this. And I think the best way to get us out of this situation is something I really wish we did after independence. Very controversial. Have a truth and reconciliation period to discuss and admit that these problems exist in the first place. I know that sounds stupid to a lot of people, but you would be shocked to know that there are people in the civil service today who cannot do basic addition, who cannot write. There are people in the civil service who are at the end of their careers and do not know how to use a computer. And the question I had to ask was, how did you get this far?
That's a good question.
How?
How did you get this far?
Like, Microsoft Word has been a thing for almost 30 years now, but you can't use it. But you occupy one of the highest positions in the civil service, but you can't use a computer. Yes, I'm being extremely specific in this case. And those who work in the civil service will never text in and say anything. I know if you're listening. I don't want you to either to get yourself in problems. But I'm just saying, like, how? How? We've manufactured this situation from the beginning. I don't know what the end game of this is. I guess just to perpetuate, to allow some people to make more money. But the way out of this, like I said, is to recognize that these things exist. The absolute recognition that the criminal justice system of this country has failed and will continue to fail hundreds, if not thousands, of Bahamians. That the crime and punishment aspect of that has failed, that you have frustrated police officers who do their jobs adequately, who will tell you how incredibly insane they feel every day when they lock somebody up for gun possession charges, and then they get bail, and then they murder somebody, and then lock them up again, and then the fella get out again, and then murder somebody else again, and how it becomes this, like, bashing your head against the wall. And you think to yourself, well, obviously the lawmakers are going to change the laws. And then you put in a criminal defense attorney in charge of that system. Oh, man, if you don't laugh. Now we're sarcastic on the eye opener, so glad you guys are tuned in. We got some texts I want to read. And that's it. This is why I usually don't be too honest about things, because then you think too much, and then your head is not hurting. Say, good morning, eye opener. Did I miss a text before this? No, it's fine. Okay. Good morning, eye opener. What we are discussing are some of the social issues in this country have been discussed, mainly by the intellectual class in Jamaica, where some of the issues mirror ours. So many of it mirrors ours. Also, many educated Bahamians are migrating from the Bahamas. A Bahamian living and working in Nashville, there has been an influx of Bahamians in the city. They are questioning why there are so many Bahamians leaving from the Bahamas. I think the push and pull factors. It says, Don, that's the million-dollar question. How did they make it this far? But yet they make time to hold big parade yesterday in celebration of what? Like, I just don't get it, bro. What are they celebrating? Someone else says, morning, my beloved eye-opener. Special thanks to Tate and Alea for remaining faithful to the show. Continue to chime in from over. I'm going to do Mr. Fireman Latino. Listen, my beloved Dawn, I like your reference to the Matrix. You're spot on. I have told your eye-opener crew and the beloved 52 and numerous others repeatedly before that too many in the majority are clueless, lost, unaware of what actually is going on. Masses of people are walking around asleep with their eyes wide open. Dawn and crew, as well as 52 and other enlightened people listening, please don't give up. You must continue to knock on the doors of minds of the masses of people so that they will one day, some way, wake up from their matrix-like, zombie-like sleep or whatever sleep they are in. Please realize and remember that people cannot work or fight for change if they continue to walk around asleep with their eyes wide open. Keep knocking on doors of their minds. Guess that's a point of encouragement for us. I actually don't feel necessarily hopeless about the Bahamas. It's kind of reminds me of this is a very good example. App example. It kind of reminds me of the 2016 presidential debates in the United States. I'm sure we all watched them. I'm sure, Aaliyah, you watched them as well. And I remember watching Donald Trump climbs, and he said some things that I'd never expected a politician in the United States to say. He called out the gun lobby and said that American politicians, he even said as president, are terrified of the NRA because the NRA gives them money and they won't do anything on these mass shootings. Of course, he also capitulated, although he did have a federal ban on bump stocks and a few other attachments to guns and chains and federal guidelines on firearm usage. I wish he had done more, but he didn't. But I am my country, and I don't get to decide. So I don't really care. They'll figure it out. But it was like, it shouldn't take a goofy character like that to have to say things that are beyond obvious. It shouldn't take somebody pointing out someone like him to point out the hypocrisy of, for instance, or any of the other conservative clowns that love to, like, vent on social media about things they think are issues. It shouldn't take these sorts of people to point out that President Obama did more drone strikes than President Bush, that he actually killed in some ways more people than previous presidents, that he was worse in many ways. It shouldn't take the truth is something that has died a very long time ago. And as you both, and I'm not asking any of you to comment on this, because I know you can't, but to see, like, especially in quote-unquote Western countries, something as simple as speaking on an issue can get you deported, can get you fired from your job, removed from academic programs, thrown out of where you live, blackballed just for saying an obvious truth about something in a Western country, right? The ones who love to lecture to countries like ours, the countries like Russia and China and India and Pakistan, most of the Caribbean and Latin America, about how you're supposed to do this democracy thing. To see those same countries, people the way they are on basic things, it's just mind-boggling to me. It's not mind-boggling, actually. It's just ironic. It's hypocritical. The irony is never lost on me. I know you can't talk in it, and I'm asking you all to either. But I wish, at least in the context of the Bahamas, and I know it's possible for people, average citizens, to see the same irony in that you should be able to see, not just in our own leaders, but those who control the, 10 to 12% of the actual Bahamian economy that exists of the Bahamas' economy. Because the majority of it is just foreign-owned, and majority of that money is just exported from the country, which is tourism. Just as something as simple as someone admitting that tourism as is practiced in the Bahamas is factually just a plantation. You don't actually own the apparatus. You don't even own the shovel or the hoe, the backhoe, or the rake that you use to work the fields. You are renting the cutlass. for someone to just admit it rather than gaslighting us on this issue. You were saying something, Tate.
I will say, I don't know if any of you were able to watch the new Mission Impossible, Dead Reckoning.
No, I haven't. Not yet. Don't spoil it.
Interesting, I'm not going to spoil it. I like to spoil things, but I'm not going to spoil it. But the movie makes an interesting point about truth and who gets to control the truth. And since October, the beginning of October, I haven't felt this much mania and insanity as much as I've felt about trying to get information about the Ukraine war, right? And so that type of information, trying to know what is the truth and having people just meddle and just muddy the waters when it comes to understanding certain things, people just blatantly lying about the truth, you know? Who bombed the hospital? Who did this? Who did that, right? It makes you crazy. It makes you feel like you're not in your right mind. And so I get that point. I really do. And then people trying to clear out that truth and trying to understand what is truly happening on the ground when it comes to the situation in Palestine and Israel, right? You see that and you trying to understand what is happening or what truth is and having that kind of muddied and not knowing who's telling the truth. It makes you want to go crazy. And people trying to speak out for that and trying to provide truth and then them being, like you say, deported or censored and trying to stand up for certain rights, that's also crazy. I just want to go back to a point that we made earlier in the show, is the fact that this is hypocritical. This is very illiberal, right? This is not liberal as liberal democracy or Western liberal democracy likes to paint themselves as. But my other concern is that what do we do when this is all over, right? Yeah. Like you said, there is a big divide, you know, between the global South and Western democracies. We've seen that there's this double standard when it comes to conflicts and who's doing what, right? There's these conflicts on standards, right? And so when this is done, if it ever is done, or what happens in the next few months, where do we go from here? Who do we trust? And I think if we continue on this path, it's gonna get worse. And we're not gonna trust anybody because nobody wants to tell the truth. And nobody wants to be honest about things for once. So I get your point. But for me, I feel like I'm going crazy listening to all this and watching what's happening in the news. So I'm just going to say that.
No, I'm with you, Tate. I think you hit the nail on the head. Mine is to add on to that. I think the only thing, global South countries can only trust ourselves. We cannot trust the North, who comes up with these pseudo-intellectual and pseudo-humanitarian efforts like the UN, which is a farce, as we've seen with this debacle based on occupied Palestine. And we can call it what it is, right? Because that's what it is. It's colonization. It's genocide at its highest form. You have to call it out. You have to. Like, you literally have to. If you don't stand for something, you will literally fall for everything. You can't be scared because years from now, you're going to wish you were one of those people who spoke out when they start coming for you and your people. Because that is, people always say that, like, oh, they're coming. But for certain communities, they're going to come for you. We saw it, just like how Dawn mentioned with Dorian. We saw it. We had a natural disaster and everyone, the coverage was terrible. I remember CNN, the anchor was pressuring me to, like, comment on the government. And I had to say, well, I have faith in my government because, you know, this is unprecedented. I'm not going to say that they're not doing what they got to do in front of these Americans. You know what I mean? Who are waiting to demonize our country. The optics of it already is off. No matter what I thought about it, because it was a terrible response that our government, that the administration had to Dorian.
Yep.
And Dorian survivors still aren't being given the support that they need, in my opinion. But we move. Anyway. I like all of those things in tandem. Tate, like, you're absolutely right. We cannot trust anyone but ourselves. Because if we trust the US, we trust the UK, France, any Western nation, we'll end up regretting it. They are not our friends. They are white supremacist demagogues and freaks who want to ruin the world that we live in for a couple dollars and for the safety and security of their own white people as the citizens who are disenfranchised in their own country continue to be mistreated. They are a cancer on our planet.
Actually, this is one of the reasons I was very glad the Bahamas didn't find oil.
Man, shoots, you right, eh?
We would have had democracy in 10 seconds. You would have seen ExxonMobil, all of them would have moved operations to the Bahamas with the swiftness. Because you know why I bring this up, right? Was that a part of that oil field also stretches into Cuba. And any opportunity to put up a middle finger or a thumb Cuba in the eye from good old Uncle Sam is not going to be missed at all. They will be on there with the swiftness. The same thing, as you see, was done in Guyana with Venezuela, who's now having a referendum on annexing basically 80% of Guyana. So we'll see how that goes.
That's going to be so interesting. It's going to be so interesting.
It is, because you will all of a sudden see, I don't know how many wars you could balance at the same time, but you'll all of a sudden see, oh, well, Guyana is a great ally of the West. We just get, it's like,
well, we see they can't balance too, because look at what's happening to Ukraine.
Oh yes, oh yes.
Zelensky is like he's now cannon fodder. I mean, he was always cannon fodder. Yeah. He's in the back. He's a backbencher.
Yes, okay. Someone texted and said, "Imagine if Haiti had oil." Eh? Let me tell you something. If Haiti would have 30 U.S. bases in it. Most of Europe would have had oh my God. I think it's probably for, I don't even say it's for the best. I don't know. I really do feel for the people of Haiti. I really wish, I hope the Bahamas never sends troops to Haiti. If we send advisors, I don't know what we advise it on either. I already spoke about this before. I won't lament that issue. Someone says, Tate, I think we're on point. You're at the point now where truth can be separated from the fact. Think about for a second. Years ago, we knew for a fact and truth were one in the same. Nowadays, I think people are finding ways to separate them to suit their own narrative and needs. Yeah. I think this started also when we had, I remember having this conversation with Joey Gaskins on the show too, about identity politics and the issue with subjective truth of people saying this is my truth versus the truth. And then it became these versions of truth. This is his truth, her truth, my truth, this country's truth. And then it's like, no, but the truth is supposed to be something like it's a rock. It's not a marshmallow. It's a rock. Mm-hmm. But to you, it's a marshmallow. And then it's a matter of perspective. Now, you can argue the semantics of this all day. But the issue of separating those two, like this person has created, they've illustrated, is that if, prime example, I love this example too. Moody's just downgraded the United States. Give them a credit rating downgrade and also said that their economy is stable but a negative outlook. They gave a whole write-up as to why they made their decision. Standard & Poor's already did this, by the way. They did this, I think, 2 months ago. They downgraded the United States as well. Excuse me. And the U.S. government this time responded. It was almost like verbatim a response of the Bahamian government. And I just burst out laughing. It was like, oh my God. The irony of it all. They were saying that the U.S. economy is strong. They put in fiscal measures and all these things to address these issues. Inflation is. And I was like, yeah, isn't this what we say all the time? Yeah. And then you see these reports come out basically saying, well, the government hasn't demonstrated blah, 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 blah. And it's just ironic and funny and hypocritical at the same time. But yes, which one of those things is true? Is it a stable but negative outlook for the country? Or is it, as the U.S. government says, that no, it's strong and it's going to improve as we're arrested and things are going to continue to improve? Which one is it? The two things cannot be simultaneously true. So when you find yourself on, and this is a, obviously a contentious thing, when because it's obviously a sovereign state versus a credit ratings bureau that also said that a lot of the bonds associated with mortgages before the 2008 financial meltdown were great.
Exactly.
So it's like, how much credibility do they have? But then it's also the same country that says, oh, well, we are pushing for an election in South Vietnam. And it was like, oh, you know what? We're not really going to do that. it's quite clear the communists are going to win. So, it's like you said, you can't really trust anybody, right? Like we're told consistently, you don't have an ambassador just yet because reasons. Get over it. It's fine. Charge the affairs. And I have no problem with the charge the affairs either. It's just...
No problem at all. I don't even know why are we so obsessed with getting an ambassador.
At this point, I don't care anymore, right? Yeah, I don't care about anything. This is the thing that I want more than anything else. More than just simply the Bahamas finally being in a situation to have a balanced budget, for us to actually have a surplus, even if the surplus is $10 freaking, man. Just for once, for us to increase revenue for the country and not massively increase spending to outpace it, and then find ourselves growing deficits over and over and over and over again. Like, I just want one thing before any of those things can ever happen. I just want the truth.
Yeah.
That's it. Very simple thing. I don't want and I'm not going to call anybody anything, but I don't want you to tell me, for instance, that the Ministry of Finance is a big place. You ain't know nothing but no hedging facilities. The financial secretary saying one thing, the minister in charge at the time, which had been Alfred Sayers, saying another thing, the prime minister saying another thing. I why am I always confused with these situations, right? Like when we had Bahama, Perry Christie say one thing, Fred Mitchell say another thing. Then you see the good negotiator, Fitzgerald, say one thing. Then you see Shane Gibson say one thing. Sox is really would go on the radio, I think at Tribune, and I'm confused again. It's like no one's story is lining up with one another. Everybody's contradicting everybody. How do I make sense and truth out of anything? And, of course, usually when those types of situations happen, it's obfuscation and it's deliberate that it's done. But that's what I'm saying. I would like for that to stop. I would like for, if you're not going to change the law on marital rape, I would have so much more respect for this administration or any if they just said, no, we're not going to change this law. Okay, good. At least you're honest about something. If you're going to change the law and you say yes, then also good. You're changing something for the better. And on top of that, you're honest. You at least tell me something and you do it. But don't tell me, for instance, I won't go through all the things, right? Because he did say he didn't talk to Sam Bankman-Fried with this and that. And then in fact, truth. Truth and reconciliation are two things the Bahamas has never had. I'm not sure there was ever a moment of clarity and truth in this country since we've been independent. It is quite clear with the lens of hindsight, Alea, if you look at the historical record of the United Bahamian Party, that the ways and means by which the PLP portrayed them wasn't always accurate. And that when you talk to Bahamians who, especially black Bahamians, who were supporters of the United Bahamian Party, and again, I'm saying, the ways and means by which they describe their personal experiences about it can change your perspective and say, maybe this wasn't as black and white, and maybe it is more nuanced than we suggested that it had been in the past. Maybe playing roots before an election all the time wasn't necessarily constructive of actually having dialogue about Bahamian history. Maybe consistently talking about slaying the big white giant, when in fact the big white giant you're talking about still operates the majority of the local Bahamian economy, and you're complicit in them doing so, and then telling the masses of this country that something is different. We've never had a moment of clarity and truth. We've been lied to basically this entire time. Something as simple as admitting, yes, cabinet approved this thing. No, I told an untruth about why this person got this contract. That just doesn't happen. Even when you had the situation with Marathon Springs, for those who don't remember, when there was a Rubus gas leak and there was benzene in the water.
That didn't happen, Don.
Yeah.
That didn't happen.
The good minister said that He knew. I'm losing job. Right? Insanity. So I say it's more, the truth is so powerful. It's so palpable. It changes the entire nature of a country. Something as simple as a parent telling the truth to their child. I ain't gonna lie, son, I can't send you off on this trip because I ain't got no money to do so. Or son, things are tough right now. I think rather than telling your child, oh, well, you ain't do good in school, or beating them, or whatever it is, obfuscating and hiding the truth, you shouldn't always tell them everything. But at the same time, build and instill a nature of truth-telling within your household.
Yeah.
And so when people get into the public fora and they ask a question about why the stains were on that young lady's dress, they don't stand up and say, I did not have sexual relations with that young lady. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't find ourselves in these situations. You wouldn't find yourself in situations where allegedly, and this is not something new or limited to any administration, it's like, oh, this person got a cabinet position because they're very good at the polling station. Wink, wink. Because you tell truth. It's important for a country to simply tell its citizens, like, tell us why you won't actually. I would like to do that. To someone in the media who works as a reporter, ask Philip Rave Davis, why will your administration not get behind, support, and implement local government in the Bahamas? Why will you not cede some of that power that you obviously cannot manage the entirety of this country from your one office? Cede some of that power to local government, who are elected officials, to govern this country, to better create better allocation of resources, find better ways to develop our communities. We don't end up in situations where you build a monstrosity. Let me not say that. Where you build a big, big hotel with no parking and then public parking at a public park, at a public beach, becomes the private parking of this business because they cannot provide transportation or parking for their own staff. And it's in front. And the biggest middle finger, I guess, to the Bahamian people in that whole situation with that hotel on Cable Beach is that it's right in front of the office of the Prime Minister. If that doesn't illustrate to you how powerless and weak state institutions are, I don't know what does. I've said a lot. I'm going to shut up now. Any thoughts, guys?
No, I think you said it well. You said it well. And I, you said it well. I can't add anything else to that.
Speechless.
I'm speechless. And you know, I've been on the show for about how long now? Almost 6 years now. I think September made it six years. And I can remember when I had my first aha moment. I think it was when we were talking about tourism. And this is when we had our old co-host, he was still on the show. And we were talking about how the tourism industry is dangerous to the Bahamas and stuff like that. And I would think after being 6 years on this, and it shouldn't, right? Because I know that this is how I should expect things to be. But it's like, sometimes when you hear these stories, they just get more worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. Like, there's no coming back from this. Like, they aren't changing their behavior. They aren't improving their behavior. They're just still doing the same things. And so I'm honestly shocked by the rent situation, and I'm shocked. I don't know if anyone from the governing party has said anything about this. I've seen people on Facebook make noise about it, who've been talking about these issues and talking about that particular program. But that's a shame, right? How do you allow for private people to basically co-opt and to take up space on a public space or a public area just because they don't provide enough parking for their employees, right? And so it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Yeah.
You would think to yourself also, well, obviously the government would never approve something like that. Obviously, the government of the Bahamas has more sense than that. You know, we have, and you know, actually, this part is funny. Some of the folks who work in town planning. I went to high school with. Right? I have some of the graduates are now engineers. I went to high school with them. We sat in the exact same homeroom at Queen's College. And I don't think they have any power to actually affect any of these things, to be honest with you. And when I think I just spoke to one the other day, and it was like, yeah, but it's just, a side gig. You know, you got to do what you got to do. I don't think they're empowered in terms of the office of town planning. I don't think they're empowered to really change much. It just doesn't seem this way, right? Because Nassau is a town planning nightmare, has always been. Future just always will be. Like, why do you have a liquor store across the road from another liquor store? If you go from Blue Hill south, if you're driving on Blue Hill right now and you can hear the sound of my voice, and you're going south or coming from South Blue Hill and driving past St. Vincent Road, you cannot help but notice that there are two liquor stores literally right in front of one another. And they block up traffic and have done so, and I guess for the foreseeable future. One used to actually be a Chinese restaurant. And I don't even know if they serve food anymore, because it just seems liquor. I guess you got to make your money, right? Make your bub. But it's insanity, for lack of a better term. And we just cannot get the honest answers to say, no, we don't know what we're doing with town planning. No, we can't figure out a better way to organize our society. And I have a solution for this. Leah, it's very controversial. You may not like it. I think the solution to this problem, especially beach access, etc., is we need to import some white people out of the country into specific neighborhoods. I think Bain Town needs to go a few shades brighter. Hear me out.
Okay.
You ever went to any of the public parks in inner city New Providence and notice, if assuming the grass is even cut, in several of them, like, it's functional. Like, the swings actually swing. You can park in there without boisting your tire. The road going to it isn't full of potholes. Have you noticed that areas where predominantly wealthier white people and wealthy black Bahamians live tend to just look better? Mainly because it's privatized. Mainly because you have, like, organisms like, what is it? Was it New Providence Development Company or something like that? But here's my solution to that. We just need to lighten the shades of some of these neighborhoods. And then all of a sudden, you will notice the parks will just work, right? You may notice sometimes that the roads may get paved on the edges. So if you drive too close to the edge, you're going to wind up blowing up your tire like I did. Maybe, Ilya, in the areas where they have beaches, the beach access will be improved. You know why? Because, you know, a little lighter now. Because you have sunlight, right, Tate? Maybe that's the solution. Maybe even, perhaps, when you lighten up some of the places and throw some money behind it, you may see garbage collected on a consistent basis, the same time every week. I know that sounds crazy to a lot of Bahamians. And I say this also. I'm sorry?
Government in the sunshine, in the whiteness.
Yes. And I say this also as I moved. I think I moved in July. And I have noticed, there's a neighborhood I've moved to is a little bit brighter, right? I've noticed a very stark difference in the services that government renders. And it's not all better because there's still potholes. But I've just noticed that it's like, maybe, it sounds crazy, Leo. Maybe that's the only language that they understand. Maybe for a lot of the constituencies, we need to get a little bit lighter people to talk to government on our behalf. Because the government don't take it seriously when dark people come to the government. No. Yeah, when you come and I want to start my business and do this, ooh, he look a little dark.
I don't think so, brother. They
just
pull out the paper bag there.
Oh, yeah.
Pull out the paper bag and be like, and then they have like a boundary brown.
But hold on, because listen, and I don't take this the wrong way. There are a lot of Bahamians who have fairer skin colors, or let me use the word fair, or brighter skin colors, even who you consider to be white, who have, I love to see it, have the strongest Camp Road / Bain Town accents you ever hear in your entire life. They smoke more weed than you, they can drink more Guinness than you. They're real. What I think you would need is some brighter, but they have to have foreign accents. They have to sound quintessentially American or British. What do you guys think?
I think
you may just be onto something.
You may be onto something for real.
Yeah. If you want to change, you want to improve Nassau Village, I think you got to, you know, get some representatives to talk on their behalf who look a little different. And then maybe, not even maybe, I'm pretty sure the perspective, because it seems like when Disney was doing the things, you know what, I'm going to leave it alone. Let me shut up. I'm going to shut up on that. It just seems as though that is the language that they understand. Because, like I said, when regular middle class or working class or just outright poor people of darker hues, or even those people but of lighter hues talk, they're not really taken too particularly serious. Because when I talk to people on the Fami Islands, they have nothing nice to say, especially white Bahamians have nothing nice to say to the Bahamian government, nor to the black ones. Nothing nice to say. So maybe if it was a foreigner represented in those places, things would absolutely change. And one of the first neighborhoods that I think could use this bit of change, taking the layout. Do you all ever drove in the neighborhoods in the back of the PLP headquarters?
Yes.
It's a different world, isn't it?
A different world, yeah, yeah.
It's like you're driving in a... I can't describe it, actually. And it's not negative in any way. I'm just saying, I think to improve some of the things that some people who live in that neighborhood have called into the show unaddressed, I think you need to get some foreign consultants from Belgium or something who have them fancy accent, and they don't say Z, but in fact they say Z. They don't say H, but they say H.
Yeah.
They don't say eggs, but let me stop getting off. I think with that, things will actually change. I think we have to, for lack of a better term, I think it's going to be a running gag on the show now, guys. The foreign consultant. That is what we need.
That's just the white South Africans.
Oh, my God, yes. Because Israel got them. Perfect. And Israel imported a lot of them just now. I think we need to get some of them here, too. they can really teach the government a thing or two. They're the greatest consultants. They know how to work this system. And I think you could really change how Nassau looks, and I think it'd also be great for the Fami Islands, because it actually is in fact happening on the Fami Islands already. If you go to Eleuthera, you can see it in Governor's Harbor. Like, you go where the Black Baymans live, it is absolutely terrible, for lack of a better term. And you go where the white foreigners live, and it's like anywhere USA. You honestly forget that you're in Eleuthera. To be quite, at least that's the way that I felt. I just felt like I was in a very upscale, rich neighborhood in Florida. I couldn't tell the difference. But when you drive down the hill and you go down where the rest of the people live, you're like, oh, yeah, I'm in the Bahamas again, because nothing is wake. And the water don't wake in these buildings properly. And the power don't stay on. And then there's a bunch of potholes. And then chickens and dogs run up and down the streets. Oh, this dog got plenty of mange. Those types of issues. I just plop one of those buildings, just plop some of those people with those fancy accents in some of these neighborhoods, and give them a cape. You have to give them a cape, Leo, and call and have on the front Savior in front of it. I think the Bahamas will change.
You may have to try it. It's crazy, but it just might work.
I agree. Frosted Flakes change the world, man. Anyway, we're almost out of time. I'm gonna read some of these texts. Says, why is there a liquor store across the road from Yellow Ella Primary School? Yes. Ooh. Yes. Thank you, caller, for saying this. I'm pretty sure this is Sparky, but yes, you're correct. Says, maybe it was a fake post, but when I read the announcement from the hotel that was posted to Facebook, they literally said they do not condone parking by Goodman's Bay. And that was a post condemning the hotel for trying to encroach on the parking lot. Let me tell you something. Fellow co-host and local provocateur and troll like myself, C.A. Nuri has literally gone there. I see posted videos of it, of literally in the first thing in the morning, and you literally can see the stream of people parking and walking to the win. They're driving for they're winning. That is the new term, what we should call it. Hashtag winning, with the W-Y NNING. Winning. Hashtag winning for the parking situation that they've managed to solve on the backs of Bahamians. Any final words before we got to go, guys?
You want to go first?
Stop trusting the West. Yeah, stop trusting the West. The West is not your friend. All it and its supporters will one day perish. Simple.
I will say, guys, everyone, the Bahamas, nothing's going to happen if we keep acting this way. Nothing's going to change. And I think you should really start looking at what your people say, looking at what your so-called leaders say, looking at, you know, what your member of parliament says. And if it's garbage, I think you should call it off for what it is. If it's garbage, say it's garbage, right? But also, I think if you truly consider yourself to be a Bahamian and someone who loves the state that you live in, love the nation that you're a part of, you wouldn't be doing this. Because at the end of the day, this political patronage system is working to our detriment. I know you feel like you might be getting a little salary or something like that, but at the end of the day, it's really killing us. And as long as we keep the system up, we're going to be a dying society. So that's my final words.
I want to read a text, but before I do, I want to say political patronage is equivalent of smoking crack. It probably, and the reality is, if you really think about it, you're still smoking crack. Someone says, very soon, if we're not careful, the entire Bahamian chain of islands will be like a loot. Oh, they really are. I don't know if anybody told you. Why do you think for decades all Bahamian governments refused to develop the Flaming Islands? The only islands that seem to be immune from some of these effects are ones that have, at least the parts of the island, I should say, where there's lots of good land, have tons of quote-unquote generation land or common edges. Those places are frozen in time, will never be developed, and you will die and come back four times over, and they will never be developed. Where there's private land, it's already too late. A lot of Cat Island, especially when I worked in real estate, and you can see the listings, a lot of the beachfront was already gone. Like, most, not all, but a lot on the islands, the beachfront's gone. The beach views are gone. They're sold. There's a good chunk still owned by Bahamians who will sell to the highest bidder. And there's no infrastructure on some of the lots. So they just be like, why are you selling this for almost $500,000 for 200 by 200 with nothing there? There's like no infrastructure for miles. But I guess, you know, they have a target audience and it is what it is. So my vote and message is, one thing I want us all to do and to work on before we gotta go now, is that we should absolutely tell the truth.
Yeah.
Say it like it actually is. If it's controversial, if it's offensive, you cannot tell the truth. Let me not say this. You cannot live your life trying to avoid not offending people. People will be offended by you calling them silly, by calling their ideas stupid. Attack the things that they say, but don't necessarily always attack people. But tell the truth. The truth, I can't believe I'm saying this. I heard this when I was in school from my religious RK teacher, right? The truth will set you free, even if it kills you in the meantime. Like we always say, with many hands build a home, many hearts build a school, but it takes many engaged Bahamians who tell the truth and say it like it is to build a better Bahamas. Be good, Bahamas.
Pressure thick and diamond. All eyes on me like a conductor. That may play a role, you might get chiming. Wait, play the game to change the game. Word to Gooch, that's my hitter. Your wave is living in the moment, huh? My wave is living, but I know what I'm doing. Yeah, I know what I'm doing.